and welcome to another episode of Science Monitor, a show that brings to you the most significant news from the world of science, technology, innovation, research, discoveries, and much more. My name is Aishwarya Kapoor, and here are this week's headlines. Scientists at CSIR and Central Salt and Marine Chemicals Research Institute in Bhavnagar, Gujarat, make a new material to fasten the process of wound healing. Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Engineering Sciences 2017 awarded to Dr. Nilesh B. Mehta for his contributions to improving wireless communication. Zoological Survey of India finds a new species of mayfly from Himalayas. Prime Minister's postdoctoral fellowship to encourage industry academia partnership in research. Our top story this week. Wounds cause a loss of blood and increase the risk of acquiring infections. Doctors have been using specialized dressings and bandages containing drugs or antibiotics to fasten wound healing. But they are expensive and less efficient. In a recent development, scientists at the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, Central Salt and Marine Chemicals Research Institute in Bhavnagar, Gujarat, have made a new material called hydrogel that can fasten the process of healing wounds. Science Monitor brings you the special report.
Whenever there is an injury, like an aberration or cut, the skin gets ruptured and exposes our body to external microbes or bacteria. This increases the risk of life-threatening infections. After the injury, wound healing begins naturally. In a normal healthy person, platelets keep circulating in the blood in an inactive state. They become active when they sense proteins like collagen in the wounds. When there is a wound, skin ruptures and platelets get access to collagen. Wound healing happens in four steps. These are hemostasis, inflammation, proliferation, and maturation. In the first step, or hemostasis, blood vessels around the wound constricts to prevent loss of blood. At the same time, special cells in blood called platelets start to aggregate at the site of the wound. Platelets aggregate at the wound and get activated by a protein fibrinogen in blood. They convert it into protein called fibrin, which forms a clot to seal the wound. The sooner the clot forms, the early is the healing. In second phase, the injury site inhibits inflammation. Cells of the immune system, named neutrophils and macrophages, accumulate in the clot area to remove damaged cells and kill bacteria that may have entered the body through the wound. The third phase, called proliferation, starts, in which new blood vessels and tissues are formed. In the last phase, called maturation, that starts a week after injury, clot is replaced with proteins like collagen that organize into thicker bundles, resulting in stronger and more rigid scar tissue. In a recent development, scientists at the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, Central Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute in Bhavnagar, Gujarat, have made a new material to speed up the natural process of wound healing. This material is called hydrogel. It is called so because it is liquid below 37 degrees Celsius or body temperature and rapidly forms a semi-solid gel. This property helps to store it as a liquid in refrigerator in hospitals. When applied on a wound, it solidifies into a gel.
This gel material, we have tested the wound healing application of these materials. This hydrogel showed rapid wound healing property, and it can be applied for biomedical applications. Initially, we have tested this hydrogel in vitro, and we want to take this work forward by testing the efficacy of this hydrogel in vivo, such as in mice model and rabbit model.
Hydrogel is made from two substances named polyethylene glycol and PDMA-BPNIPAM, which cross-link and form a gel. This mixture is applied on a wound or ejected near the wound. The two substances react with each other and rapidly form a gel within 4 minutes time and cover the wound. This prevents loss of blood. It also binds to a protein called fibrinogen in the blood. When platelets arrive at the wound site, they are absorbed on hydrogel because it has a porous sponge-like structure. This helps in early initiation of wound healing process. Hydrogel has an added advantage. It does not produce heat or chemical byproducts at the site of injury. The findings were published in the journal Materials Chemistry B, issue 25, year 2017. It was done by Shivnada University in Uttar Pradesh and Jawaharlal Nehru University and the Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research in New Delhi. If tested safe and efficacious in animals, hydrogel will be taken for trials in humans. It can help doctors to manage skin abrasions and minor cuts with lesser medicines and time.
Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, the highest Indian honor in the field of sciences, is awarded every year to eminent researchers in various disciplines. This year, in the field of engineering sciences, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize has been conferred to Dr. Nilesh P. Mehta of the Indian Institute of Science, Bengaluru, for his contributions to 5G technology and improving wireless communication. Science Monitor team brings you this report.
From our smartphones, Wi-Fi internet in office to GPS navigation in cars, we are using wireless communication every day in our lives. In wireless communication technology, data is transferred without using wires. Data, which is defined as information processed or stored by a computer in the form of Word document, images, pictures, audio clips, or software programs, is sent from one device to another through radio and microwaves. The amount of data is measured in a unit called byte. A byte, in other words, is similar to a packet of information. 1 kilobyte or KB, for example, contains 1024 bytes of data. Today, it is possible to transfer huge amounts of data from one device to another at lower costs because we have 4G, or the fourth generation wireless communication technology, in our devices. Before 1980, there was just 1G, when it was possible to transfer only low amounts of data. Soon 2G and then 3G came, where the speed of data transfer could be increased by nearly 30 times. Now, India is targeting to achieve 5G in wireless communication by 2020. In this, speed of data transfer will increase by more than 1 gigabytes per second at very low costs. The Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize, which is the highest honor in the field of science in India, has been awarded to Dr. Nilesh B. Mehta this year for engineering sciences. He is a faculty at the Indian Institute of Science, IISc, Bangalore. He has been chosen for his incredible contributions to improve wireless communication, which aims to meet the target of 5G in the future.
It's a privilege to get the award. It's a fairly eminent committee that decides the awards, and they also get opinions from subject matter experts, people in my area, people I respect a lot and who are my role models. And these are the people who write references for the award. So when you finally get the award, it does make you very happy because some very eminent experts have judged your work.
Dr. Mehta and his team are helping to achieve 5G communications by improving the design of communication devices such as phones and modems. Typically, for wireless communication, many devices like phones or internet modems are connected to network computers in which transfer of signals is through antennas. Present-day devices like phones have a separate transmitter and receiver. A transmitter sends out signals to network computers and a receiver senses incoming signals. Dr. Mehta is trying to make devices with single equipment that can transmit and receive signals at the same time. This is done by combining the transmitter and receiver on a single chip platform. Along with this, it also needs better computer programming, which is done by writing efficient computer programs. Dr. Mehta and his team are trying to come up with a better computer program to make simultaneous transmissions and sensing of signals possible. Recently, he has developed a new computer program that reduces the time required for a computer to process communication signals. This will make 5G devices faster and more efficient and smaller in size.
The main thing that we work on is wireless communication systems, and I personally think that the future for wireless is very bright. We are already very familiar with cellular systems. All of us are familiar now with terms like 3G, 4G, and now the world is very rapidly moving towards 5G. And in 5G, what we are going to see, and already we are seeing this in 4G, is systems with much faster data rates, much lower latencies, which means you don't have to wait for the signal to go and come back essentially through the network. And also for the operator, an ability to service many more users. So it's much cheaper for him to also run the network. And the research we're doing there does feed into that big research effort worldwide on this.
Dr. Mehta completed his BTech from the Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, his MS in Engineering at the California Institute of Technology, USA, and got his PhD in Electrical Engineering from the prestigious Stanford University in USA before joining the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore as faculty. He won the Young Engineer Award of the Indian National Academy of Engineering in 2010 and the NASI Scopus Young Scientist Award in 2014. He has authored nearly 50 research papers in leading journals and is working to make 5G a reality in the coming future.
It's time for a very short break here, but when we return, we will show you the new species discovered by the Zoological Survey of India. So keep watching Science Monitor.
Hi, I am Dr. Mabali Rajan. I am a senior scientist in Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology that is coming under CSIR. We are going to discuss my lab, who is doing a fantastic work in asthma, COPD, lung cancer, and other many other diseases. Keep watching Eureka.
One of the most influential revolutionaries of Indian freedom struggle, Shahid Bhagat Singh. Born into a Sikh family, patriotism flowed in his blood at the age of 13. When he formed Naujawan Bharat Sabha to spread the message of revolution in Punjab. In the wake of avenging Lala Lajpat Rai's death, Bhagat Singh and his associates coined the catchphrase Inqilab Zindabad. But towards the end of their rebellion, they had to pay a heavy price for their patriotism. Following the blasts inside the corridors of the assembly, both Bhagat Singh and Batukeshwar Dutt courted arrest. Bhagat Singh was sent to the gallows in Lahore with his fellow comrades, after which he was cremated in Husainiwala on the banks of Satluj.
Welcome back. After the break, you're watching Science Monitor. Mayflies have fascinated zoologists for a long time. These insects spend most of their life in water and come to land for a short duration for reproduction. They are important chains that interlink the food chain on water and land. More importantly, they are used as indicators of a water quality of a region. A recent study from the Zoological Survey of India has found a new species of mayfly from the Himalayas and confirmed that it is endemic to this region. Science Monitor brings you this fascinating report.
The Zoological Survey of India in Kolkata has found a new species of mayfly from the Indian Himalayas. This species is endemic to the Himalayas, which is a biodiversity hotspot of the country. Mayflies resemble dragonflies and damselflies, as they are medium-sized insects with narrow body, long wings and legs. They are named after the month in which they mostly breed, that is May. These flies have fascinated zoologists and scientists since a long time. They spend most of their life in water and few weeks on land. The females lay hundreds of eggs in water and promptly die. These eggs hatch to become larvae, which grow for a few months in water, become adults and fly to the land. The adult flies reproduce on land. This is how the population of mayflies is maintained. Interestingly, mayflies feed on algae in water, where fishes and water beetles also eat them. When they become adults and reach land, frogs, birds and small rodents eat them. In this way, they act as an important link between the food chains of water and land. There is one more reason why scientists look forward to studying mayflies. They act as indicators of water quality of a region. Several studies have shown that mayflies can survive and grow in clean water, but fail to tolerate polluted water. In this way, by evaluating the abundance of diversity of mayflies in a water body, scientists can predict if a region is suffering the brunt of pollution.
We collected the samples from Meghalaya and Himachal Pradesh. During the identification process, we find that this is differs from other population of this same genus insects. So we describe it as a new species based on their gill structure and morphological characters like legs and mouth parts. This is the diagnostic character of this new species.
The new species of mayfly discovered from the Himalayas is different from other members of mayflies in some features. It has smaller mouth parts and brown spots on the legs, which are unique. Scientists found this new species from Rangbuk, Umkan and Vankwar riverine streams in Garo and Khasi Hills in Meghalaya, and the Mandodari River in Himachal Pradesh. There are 2,500 species of mayfly known in the world, and only about 25 are known in India. In addition to the Himalayas, mayflies are also found in other areas of the country, like in the eastern and the western Ghats. Finding this new species opens the possibility to study riverine ecosystems of the Himalayas. Scientists are now planning DNA-based studies to find information on other features which makes this new species unique.
The Prime Minister's postdoctoral fellowship is awarded each year as a public-private initiative by the Science and Engineering Research Board under the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India and the Confederation of Indian Industry. Through this collaboration, researchers are supported financially and can pursue their PhD degree while undertaking industrial research in their field of study. Science Monitor brings you an elaborate report on this fellowship.
Prime Minister's Fellowship Scheme for doctoral research by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, is a public-private partnership initiative of the Science and Engineering Research Board, or SERB, and Confederation of Indian Industry, or CII. The fellowship covers areas like science, technology, engineering, agriculture, and medicine. This fellowship scheme commenced in the year 2013. The scheme invites applications from doctoral fellows who are enrolled in recognized universities and institutions to pursue research on industrially relevant projects. To apply for this scheme, the doctoral fellow, along with an industry partner, has to file a joint nomination. The doctoral fellow must be registered as a full-time PhD scholar in the last 14 months from the date of submission of the application. Before applying, it is mandatory for the applicant to select an industry partner or a co-applicant to support the research project financially and technically. The candidates must select a topic of research with a practical relevance and industrial application.
Prime Minister Doctor Research Fellowship is initiated with the objective to have industrial participation in research. The doctoral research student is working in both the environment, academic and industrial environment. In this, 50% research grant comes from academia institute and 50% from industry.
Prime Minister's fellows are provided with a grant of rupees 8.7 lakh per annum, of which the government provides 50% of the amount and the balance 50% is sponsored by an industry partner. The duration of the fellowship is maximum of 4 years, and in the end, the fellows are awarded with a PhD degree. A total of 100 fellowships are provided every year. For further information, candidates can visit the website www.primeministerfellowshipscheme.in. The fellows can do research in leading industries like Anna University, Banaras Hindu University, Indian Institute of Engineering, Sciences and Technology. The candidates can apply for this fellowship anytime within 14 months from the final date of PhD registration and admission. Over the past 4 years, about 30 institutes and more than 50 companies have come together to support the scheme. The focus of the Prime Minister's joint scheme for doctoral fellows and industry is to attract large number of talented students to pursue a PhD in industrially useful projects, which will help to bring in more investment in research and development from private industrial partners.
It's time for another short break here. When we come back, we will bring you some more news on science and innovation from India and around the world. But that's after a short break, so keep watching Science Monitor.
Art, arisen from a multi-hued cultural canvas. Tradition and cultural fervor dating back centuries. And encircling them all, there's a magic that awes. Embrace your nation's brilliant human warmth. Watch Colors of India, Sundays at 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back after the break. Let's now take a quick look at some more scientific innovations and developments from India and around the world.
Indonesian authorities have issued a high alert and the evacuation zone has been widened, fearing a major volcanic eruption from Bali's Mount Agung. Dark smoke and ash have been rising up to 11,150 feet above the mountain, which has been emitting fire since a few days. Officials have warned residents to stay away from rock and debris flows known as lehars, which have been spotted flowing down from the mountain. The last time Mount Agung erupted in 1963, where 1,000 people were killed. Researchers at the Indian Institute of Technology Roorkee have come up with a new and cost-effective method for production of biofuel to meet the increasing demand of fuel requirement in the country. IIT Roorkee for the first time investigated the use of crude glycerol for heterotrophic cultivation of microalgae in photobioreactor in order to enhance automotive quality biodiesel production. The focus of the study was to overcome the cost related to production of biodiesel from microalgae and develop a method that is fast and cost-effective. A new gene therapy has helped restore vision in people who had lost their sight to an inherited retinal disease. The disease is called Leber congenital amaurosis, or LCA, which progresses slowly but eventually causes complete blindness. Researchers from the University of Iowa in the US showed that 27 out of 29 treated patients experienced considerable improvements in their vision, allowing them to get around without a cane. The researchers presented the results of the study at the 121st annual meeting of the American Academy of Ophthalmology 2017 in New Orleans. The new gene therapy is currently under the US Food and Drug Administration review. A cost-effective soil testing solution was recently developed by students of IIT Roorkee to help farmers by boosting the productivity of crops. The solution, known as Solving Nitrogen Application Problems, or SNAP, can achieve this by balancing the use of fertilizers. The optical imaging application can determine optimum fertilizer input by performing multispectral imaging of the crop leaves. The camera module has been programmed in such a manner that the image of the leaves will help to determine the soil's nitrogen content. The International Vaccine Conference was organized by the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, or ICGEB, from November 27th to 29th in New Delhi, with a focus on vaccine development. Dr. Harshvardhan, the Minister of Science and Technology and Earth Sciences, inaugurated the event. The three-day event aimed at bringing together scientists from across the world to brainstorm on discoveries that will facilitate future vaccine research on diseases such as Zika virus disease, HIV and tuberculosis, etc.
And in the history of our science, this week we remember Sir Jagdish Chandra Bose, popularly known as J.C. Bose. He was born on 30th of November 1858. Sir Bose was a physicist, biologist, biophysicist, botanist and archaeologist, and an early writer of science fiction. He made significant contribution in the investigation of radio and microwave optics. He played an instrumental role for starting experimental science in India. He was the first to use semiconductor junctions to detect radio signals through a device, coherer. Sir Bose pioneered in plant science and invented the crescograph, a device that measures the growth of a plant. Conducted his first experiments with a leaf, a carrot, and a turnip. Through this device, he researched on the response of the plants to fertilizers, light rays, temperature, and wireless waves. Sir Bose was famous for his books like Response in the Living and Non-Living, which was published in the year 1902, and The Nervous Mechanism of Plants in 1926. Sir Bose became the first Indian biophysicist to be honored by the Royal Society in 1920. He passed away on 23rd of November 1937 at the age of 78. He was felicitated by several distinguished honours like Companion of the Order of the Indian Empire in 1903 and the Knight Bachelor in 1917. Dedicated to scientific research, the Bose Institute, established by Sir J.C. Bose, completed 100 years of existence this year. Sir Bose's legacy in so many fields continues to be an area of research for several scientists even today. Well, that is all for this episode of Science Monitor. You can send your feedback and suggestions to Science Monitor on our email ID news@vigyanprasar.gov.in. You can also write into us at Vigyan Prasar C24, Kutub Institutional Area, New Delhi 110016. I'll see you again next week with another episode of Science News and Innovations. Till then, goodbye and take care.